Called to order today at 2:00 here in the rainy town of Sharon. Start off with any public comments.
Hi, Brent. Bob Lux, and I would just like to commend you on what's happened in this last week regarding town crew. It was long overdue, long needed, and I praise you for taking the time and keeping everything in order and making the decisions you made. I know the job is going to be open to the public, but there's several good men in town, and but I'll mention in their names either, that are interested in the job, and I think that if we have somebody that's in town, I think that they should be given preference, response time for snow and emergencies and things like that, and they would probably take more ownership to the town than somebody that was not from our village. This is a good time for the board to work together and make some good choices. I don't think that we need any showboating about this or anything like that. I just think that for the future of the town, and if anybody has future aspirations about public office here, I think this is a good time to work together. And I think that I have just one other comment about the Sharon Ridge. I know that there's talk going on about that, but that is a completely separate entity, and I think it should stay that way. I know you have to appoint somebody to the board up there, but I can't see that the town getting too heavily involved in that and becoming a landlord or that sort of thing. I think that should stay a separate entity. Thank you, Brent.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bob.
Thank you, Bob.
Anybody else? Move right into it. Concert series obviously has been very popular in town, and a lot of people come out to it. And Al's right on it. He's already ready for next year. And these are the dates that he'd like to submit for the summer of next year.
Do you have any conflicts?
Yeah, I would assume there aren't any. Tina,
at this point, I wouldn't think so.
I'll make a motion that we approve the dates for the summer concert series as presented by Al Torrella.
Enthusiastically second.
Yes, all those in favor?
Aye.
Excellent. Next up, Helen Dengener has resigned from the Board of Assessment Appeals.
So how's that going to work? How will that position be?
Well, it could be left open until after the election.
She's a regular member, right?
Yes, yes.
We have an alternate to fill until then?
Well, there's really nothing going on except for motor vehicles in September, and the two existing members could handle it.
Is a quorum. Is a quorum.
Correct.
Okay, because it's a three-member?
Yes.
Okay.
So you could wait till after the election and then see what happens at the election, and otherwise you can appoint somebody.
And who makes that decision?
Board of Selectmen.
Okay.
Yep. At this point.
All right. So we're not under any big make any big changes?
No.
And her resignation is effective immediately? As the end of July.
Right.
Okay, so she's gone. All right.
If we don't have any pressure, then maybe we should wait till after the elections, and then we'll know who in town may have been a candidate.
I think it would be better because we have people running, and we have some good candidates for that board. Mm-hmm. So if one of them doesn't happen to get in, there might be an option of moving someone in.
Correct.
Moving an alternate around. Yeah, I agree with you. Let's wait till after the election on it.
Okay.
Okay.
Motion to accept.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Next up, surprisingly, we had another offer for the Silver Lake Shores properties that we approved of.
Yes, and then
previously, so you guys got that. Basically, we did the abutting landowners, but we neglected a few who lived across the street. So they submitted their bid as well for the property.
Are they contending in this letter that because a notice was not received by the Silver Lake Shores Association that our offering out there is not valid? Is that what I'm getting from this? No?
No.
They just weren't made part of it. They weren't made aware of it. Partially, we should have considered the people next door as well. But this gives us two offers, and this goes to zoning?
Zoning tomorrow night.
But We've already accepted one offer.
Correct.
How can we accept two?
We have a phone call into Judy Dixon, just for clarification.
Because I don't think it's fair to the first offer.
Well, okay, what I think you would do to planning and zoning is just a report on selling the lots, period. Then take both offers to town meeting. Let the town decide which party.
So by accepting the offer last time we met on this, that does not constitute approval of that offer?
Correct, correct.
PNC has to act on it.
Well, I know they do, but it doesn't, but what I'm saying, it doesn't constitute approval on, from us either.
No. Because what I think could happen, even without this letter, at town meeting,
the town could deny.
They could speak up the meeting and say, well, I offer such and such.
Anything could happen.
Anything could happen.
All right. So do we need to make any action on this, or?
We need to action on it to move it to planning.
Planning and zoning, I think, yeah, okay.
And we'll still move.
I will second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Next up is the request from.
Can I just ask a question before we go on? I'm Matt Schwartz, I wrote the letter.
Oh, hi, Matt.
Hi, how are you?
See you come in.
And it's just, I guess, how the process works. I followed those lots, they're right across my driveway, 30 feet from, you know, my property line. And it's almost like I hesitated in the window of time that I followed those lots. And two of them I know were involved in a California company that bought them, and they were resold as an investment property for an exorbitant amount of money. I don't know if you're aware of the history of them. I followed them over the years. And it's like I paused and they were for sale in the paper and an offer had been made. So that's why I ask, you know, that in the past, that Silver Lake Shores did get some kind of notification. And that's how I would find out, because the people who you send the notices to, they're single empty lots that have no attention paid to them in 60, you know.
Plus years.
Plus years. So, and I bought, you know, a number of lots around my property in the past. So yeah, just would appreciate that. And my other question is there still a question? You said somebody's going to look into it. I don't know if that's the legal person of the town. One offer's been made. Is it possible that this would go into a potential now sealed bid kind of a thing from, if two parties? I mean, I came into it, I will say, knowing that there'd already been an offer made and what that offer was.
I think it would be acted on at town meeting.
I think town meeting would just decide.
I think that's what it is. We would bring both accepted bids, not approved bids.
Right, right.
Because of course, it's up to the whole town to approve, but we would present two separate bids.
Yeah, okay. Great.
That's what we know at this point. But I think we're wanting to get verification from the attorney on that, just to make sure we're doing it correctly.
And I'll call you soon as I get that.
Okay, thank you, I appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
Brent, you know, I was on the CBA for 19 years. And one of the things that they did is they required that you had these, all the lots are 40 by 90 up there, that you had to have at least five lots in order to build a house on, but to get the separation of well and septic tank. So anybody that would buy one lot, they could put a picnic table on it, I suppose.
And just say, these lots are kind of landlocked, if you will.
Yeah.
They border three or four roads, depending, I guess, on how you look at Fenton Road. And the six lots or whatever are owned by five different parties. And they could never meet 30-50 setback. They couldn't meet septic. They couldn't meet well issues. You know, yeah, it's right next door to my house, so that's my only interest. I won't be building a house for anybody.
Thank you, Matt.
Thank you very much, I appreciate it.
Back to the green request from the Women's Services. That's the Kinnell Light virtual that they have every year. That will be held on the 13th, that's 6.
I'll make a motion that we approve the request from Women's Support Services to use the green on October 13th at 6 for the annual candlelight vigil.
I'll second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Next up are tax refunds from Donna, largely overpaid.
Yeah, I think there's three of them there.
There's three overpaid.
Pinch off overpay of real estate, property?
Yeah, that was a court settlement.
Okay. I think this is the court settlement.
No, that's the court settlement.
That's the court settlement, okay.
Yeah.
And then Haver, they're all property. Okay. No, wait, this one is. This is a car.
I'll make a motion that we approve these tax refunds as submitted by the tax collector.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Excellent. Next up is the request from the town clerk. She would like to be a part of a pilot program. It has to do with the register of voters and the state. 20 or so towns would be selected for this, and she's hoping to be one. It's a progressive program about campaign finance.
So what's happening in this program? What are they trying to accomplish?
She says in the letter, they're trying to see how well it would work with this new system. So they're having test towns.
Is this part of the problem they had in the last election with, I know they had a problem in Hartford and some other towns about election procedure? Is this sort of?
No.
It's not about election day. It's not about election day.
It's financing, it's campaign financing forms.
This is kind of the short form, kind of bulleted explanation.
The study shall include an analysis of the, one, cost to municipalities of maintaining the filing repository function, including but not limited to costs associated with personnel, equipment, software, hardware, server space. Two, capacity of the offices of participating clerks of municipalities to assist with centralized filing repository duties. So it looks like what they really want to see is how hard this is for towns to do and to keep track of, which, from what I understand, it is a task and a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
What does this mean as far as a time commitment on the town clerk's part to take part in this, and does it interfere with their existing duties?
I think really the theme here is that she wants a chance to be a part of it. She's always into that progressive mode in terms of how things are done in town offices, and this, we need to give her the opportunity to be in this program through our board. So
and then that has to go to town meeting as well.
Right.
I say more power to her. She's she's come home for it.
Yes,
that's great. No, I think it's good that they're doing this, and she'd be a really good addition to this program. It looks like she has to be chosen, though. She's not
right. It's not automatic. Right.
Right. Right. I'll make a motion that we approve the town clerk to apply for the pilot program for municipal campaign finance.
I have to approve it to town meetings.
I would approve it to go to town meeting.
Yep, they have to.
And second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Right, so now we need to set town meeting.
I would wait until after we get the Silver Lake Shores thing, do that all at the same town meeting.
Okay, so you'll just keep us on our toes on that?
Yeah.
Yeah, when it's falling into lines, we can put it on the calendar.
Right. It was crazy to have all two town meetings and pay for legals and.
True.
Yep.
Dates for the interviews of the road crew members.
Okay.
How many candidates do we have that we want to, that in your purview, Brent? That
there are seven here and you have four highlighted?
Those just the ones that are highlighted live in this town.
I see.
Broke it out by number, and those are the ones that live in town, but call it blue.
Does the number correspond to how you prioritize them in terms of skill level, or is it just a
just
number you assign?
Just numbers.
Oh, okay. All right.
As they came in, we numbered them, just like last time.
All right. So random.
So how many total applicants did we get?
17.
17. And we've got seven here that you think have the requisite skill set to
right.
Warrant an interview.
So basically boiled it down by who can really plow in a commercial plow truck.
Okay.
Or has the license that allows them to do so. But largely the plowing is the biggest thing.
Sure.
Okay. So we want to do like we did last time with 2 days of interviews. Give them two choices. Isn't that what we did?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, I think that's what we did.
Yeah, seems like it.
It's a matter of availability.
Two sessions.
Right. So we give them two choices.
You want to look at something like we've done in the past? We've looked at some later afternoon opportunities, so it doesn't interfere with the candidates'
work schedules.
Yes.
Right.
I'm wide open. Baseball season's over, so I'm pretty free.
Okay. Vacation. I took it, unfortunately.
At least you got one.
At least I got one. Do you want to start next week with us?
Next week is probably good. Let's not keep these guys waiting.
Okay. Do you want to...
Want to look at Tuesday?
Yeah.
Tuesday?
Tuesday.
5:30?
Am I early? That doesn't really work for me. Could we do...
4:30?
4?
4:00 early, can you?
Actually, can we do a Wednesday? Sorry.
No, Wednesday's not good.
Getting too booked up. Okay, 18th at 4? Is that okay?
Yep, and then until when?
Till 5:30. We'll allow, don't we allow about half hour?
Yeah.
The candidates, so we'll try to handle three of them this time.
Then next day would be Thursday?
Okay. And that would be, actually, I have a meeting at...
4:30.
I do, so I'm out. We could do Friday, but probably nobody wants to...
Hey, you want a job, you gotta come.
Well, are you guys all right with Friday? I'm good with Friday.
I'm all right, it's all good.
Are you all right with Friday?
What's the day on Friday?
The 21st.
First.
We could also do Monday.
Yeah, no, let's do Friday. Let's try to get this done in a week's time.
Okay. So do you want 4:00 on Friday?
Yep.
The 21st, 4:00 to 5:30? So that gives us, let's see...
We might be here till 6:00 if we save. Depending on how the candidates fall in, we're gonna be ending up with, if they all show, three one day, four another, so...
I was just trying to figure that out. Okay. All right.
Based on avails, Brett, when you contact these individuals? You know, if it's four earlier in the week and three on Friday, that's fine, or the other way around, whichever would work for the candidates.
Okay.
Perfect.
All right.
And then what are Brent's options if none of them can show up till like 5:00? You know, if they're already out of work, you know, if they're working, if they don't get out of work till 4:30, 5:00?
Then...
Is it later, okay, with you guys then?
Question, Gina. I'll be paid the big money, isn't it? 5:00, I mean, I can go on Tuesday, the 18th, and Friday until how long it takes, but I don't know about my coworkers here. Are you all right?
I'm pretty open. You know, it's gotta be a little later. Yeah, let's try and nail down the dates. And if we got it, if, we'll push hard for 4:00.
Just email us and let us know if we need to be flexible on that time.
You know, I mean, chances are you've got a candidate, the 4:00 is fine. Another guy says, I can't get here till 5:00.
We could set it, we could go ahead and set it 4:00 to 6:00. We could just go ahead and do 4:00 to 6:00.
Tell them 4:00 to 6:00, and try to block them in, and see where we can go.
Okay.
I'll start tonight.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Sure. Next up is road work. We're getting a lot done on Sharon Station Road.
Yeah.
Apologies to Sharon Ridge for the inconvenience this week, but they got across the road pretty quickly. And Ed, you're correct, it's all built up on slag.
It's quite a history lesson down there.
It is.
It is.
I dropped down in one of the ditches with Brent, and I'm looking at the layers of asphalt, and then asphalt and slag and ground and lime and more. It's just, it's crazy.
The road right by the kiln was 7 feet lower when the kiln was operating.
Yeah.
It really built up nice. So that, they got through with that. What we're doing right now is we're gonna let it settle and see how it goes with the cross pipes. And then the idea, like we did with Dawn Hill, is to give it a layer and see how things go over the winter time, again, because we don't want it to settle and ruin the entire road. But it'll be a lot safer. So this week, they'll be doing, if you drive up that way, you'll see the swale. A lot more water's gonna get off the road and stay off the road, which is nice, because the road's actually naturally pitched this way, so...
Yeah, adding in the drainage, the same way they did on Dawn Hill.
Right.
Really is gonna be critical for that spot.
Yes.
That's our biggest project, and I'm really happy with how that's turning out. It's been a nice experience. The other thing we're working on right now is over on Cary Hill. That water damage has gotten a lot worse, so we had to cut the edge up because it's coming up in chunks like puzzle pieces, which is basically each year, you know, on the stone roads like that, and that's what the layers are coming up.
Even with the little amount of rain that we had, it's busting up?
It's just crumbling. It's a mixture of a lot of things. The rain that took it completely apart occurred late fall and then over the winter. So what you're getting now is just, you know, the fallout, because once one section breaks, it just crumbles.
Sure.
So we're cutting that away and doing the best we can and working with contractors to see who could be available to, you know, get it back together. It's just one of those unknown things you can't really plan for that happen. Bob knows all about that. Dirt roads have held up. Some pocking, but other than that, everything's good. I got a list from Scott as to how much we got done in terms of materials on all of them. So I will break this, you know, back into my spreadsheet. So he gave a good update on that. So, and overall, with the roads, that's what's going on right now. Just some work right now over on Stonehouse Road, and doing some more planning on the bridges, because that's a big deal.
Yeah.
Yep. Anyone else have any concerns on your roads? Can you tell me about them? Your roads okay?
Everything's good, Brent. Everything's good.
Excellent.
Real good.
I take care of my own.
I know, yeah, it's a nice road. I actually saw a guy on a 10 speed going across there, which is rare.
Oh, God bless him.
So that's that.
You don't get out on your 10 speed much, Scott?
yeah. I don't think I've gotten on one of those in 35 years.
Can you even find a 10 speed anymore?
No. I probably destroyed it with a machine.
Probably did. And went, oops.
Right.
I probably didn't need to go, oops.
For today's history moment, we have a special guest, Mr. Ed Kirby, who is coming here today to tell us about his latest book, which just went to the printer last week.
Let me swing around this side of the table. A little hand here. This book is going to be titled, what is it anyway? So look it up. Industrial Sharon. That's a fine thing. I can't remember the title of my own book. With three subtitles, From Ancient Rocks to Thriving Industry to Pastoral Beauty. And I think that's fitting with the ancient rocks, because the reason you had industry here is what was in the land, the kinds of things we thought. Most people are aware of at least this in industry, the Sharon Valley Kiln, although unless they read the signs, a lot of them don't know what it is, but it's there, we have it preserved, and we like to do some more work on that. But the main thing that really ran most of the iron industry in Sharon Valley and in a lot of other areas was the Sharon Valley Furnace. This furnace was built in 1825 by a man by the name of Lamont Bradley. And Bradley was kind of an interesting character. He built a furnace up at Great Falls and was supplying iron to Horatio Ames, of the where the name Amesville came from. Which is one of the things that, as soon as you start doing a book on one town, you're immediately in the other. So this, I wander around a lot in his history. It doesn't all stay in Sharon, because he has so many connections and so many links. And some work even beyond this that I'm doing right now, finding very strong links between the big four that built the Transcontinental Railroad, the Central Pacific part, were very tightly enhanced with the guys that were around here that were making iron as well. This furnace was one of Barnum Richardson's furnaces by 1873, and when Barnum Richardson came in, it became the Sharon Valley Iron Company. And so if you go and look up in the town records downstairs and find out who the Sharon Valley Iron Company was, it's all the same guys that ran Barnum Richardson. And all they had 8 furnaces around here. They leased 3 others up in Massachusetts. They owned the Millerton furnace. They had a foundry in Lime Rock where they made about 80 railroad car wheels a day. They had a foundry in Chicago. They had a foundry along with Collis Huntington, one of the big four, down in West Virginia. So they were making iron down there as well. And everything was made from Salisbury iron. And Salisbury iron is a little tricky, because all Salisbury iron didn't come from Sharon. Salisbury iron primarily came from the edge of the Taconic Range right over here, between the marble and the bottom, right by the kiln, and the schist that sits on top of it. But the Salisbury iron, William H. Barnum, who was quite a character himself, when he was in business, he also ran iron making in Michigan, and there he had 2 mines, one named Salisbury, one named Barnum. So if you want Salisbury iron, you could also go to Michigan, even though it wasn't the same as the iron that was here. One of the things I tried to do in this book is to do a lot more with characters. These are guys that worked in the Malleable Iron Works, where they did things in sand casting and things like that. Notice the difference in tools. And you show this to kids, and they'll say, "Oh, it must have been go to work with daddy day. It wasn't. These kids, when they went to work, when they went there, they were working too. And we talk about them in this book as mainly gophers. Go for my sledgehammer, go for my shovel, go for all of those things. One of the emphasis areas I've tried to do is to deal with the elements it takes to make an industry. You need something in all of these things or it doesn't work. And the one that really surprised me, because I think more of the natural resources, working with the iron and everything, this one right down here in the Sharon records is massive. Mary and I went out and went through the records, and I don't know if you know it or not, but in the Valley Tavern, I know none of you have ever been there, but there's this little tavern down the valley that used to be the main office for the Sharon Valley Iron Company. And back in the 1980s, Jody Kane found upstairs the records from 1872 to 1892. And they were taken out of there by the Sharon Historical Society, and we didn't have the facility to take care of things like that, so they're in the Connecticut Historical Society. So it's an hour and a half out, an hour and a half back every time we look at them. But you look in there and you see the amount of money that was paid for transportation, and much more than today. And you just think of, you take iron out of the furnace down the valley and you're shipping it over to the railroad in Sharon Station. And in order to go up that hill, you need two yoke of oxen just to pull a ton of iron up that hill. And you couldn't carry much more than a ton of iron on those wagons anyway. So that's something that I found was really interesting. The book has also takes care of some of our characters. Romulus Riggs Colgate, known as Rome Colgate, who built the mansion down here. Most people don't realize he was the first president of California Gas and Electric, which is now Pacific Gas and Electric, and he lived in Sharon at the same time as Frank Sprague, and Frank Sprague was known as the father of electric traction, main man in building trolley car lines, built the first one in the 1880s in Richmond, Virginia, and also in building vertical things. And what he did was to make the cities larger, because now he could build the buildings higher with the elevators. Incidentally, when he retired, he sold everything to Otis, and so Otis Elevator was the one that really got most of the credit on something like that, even though he developed it. And by having the trolleys, people could come into the town easier, and that really led a lot to the expansion of the eastern cities in the U.S. There'll be a lot in here on people, and there'll be a fairly sizable appendices covering things. There'll be a map in there, 1874 map by Beers, which shows all the school districts, and then there's a page that identifies what things were in each one of those school districts to help people that are interested in pursuing this a little bit further. Things in there, also school reports by district. Interesting to look at, I think this year what Sharon has with the high school, 180 students, and 74, 71 at elementary school, 180 students, and 71 at the high school. In 1874, the total enrollment in all these one-room schools and one two-room schools was a total of 640 kids. Whoa. So there were a lot more kids around in that time, even though the population wasn't that much much greater. But if you have situations like this where you need kids, then you have more.
Edward, didn't we have you told me a couple of years ago, didn't we have 18 school districts in Sharon?
A total of 18 school districts, and just the one up where the Sharon Center is now was the only two-room school. And they had two teachers in that one. And the school years are run a little bit different too, because the kids are out in those days, and we're still locked into this a little bit. The reason school starts a little bit late is to have more kids around for harvest and things like that, and trying to get them out earlier. More of the schools operate in the middle of the summer than operate in the winter. The reason for all the small schools was you didn't have the transportation to get people to additional schools. So all I can say about this is it's a lot of fun. It's right now, it's the text is down in Georgia getting put together. I was allowed 80 photographs for the book. So far I have 104, and no one said anything yet, so I don't know what's going to happen there. And I can't guarantee when it comes out, but we've scheduled it for November, we hope to have it, because it's nice to sell those before Christmas, because even the people that can't read buy them for Christmas and give them to somebody else, so that's part of our sales. You got a question?
No, sir.
Okay.
You gonna have them down at the Historical Society?
Yeah, we'll have an opening for that at the Historical Society.
Great, thank you, Ed.
Hope to make a little party.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you, Ed.
Thank you, Ed.
Thank you.
Well done.
All right, that's it for the normal part of the meeting. We're now gonna go into executive session.
I'll make a motion that we go into executive session.
Second.
Anyone minus the press that wishes to stay can stay to share your side of the story as well. There's some gentlemen outside of like, yeah.
Okay.
We're gonna be discussing some things that went on, and I just don't want to air the papers.
Can't do that, sir.
Well, it's executive session.
Yeah, so people can't. You can't just throw the press out.
Yeah, I don't want to have this in the paper.
Okay, but it's not, it's either all or, you can invite people and they have something to do.
I do, that's what I'm doing right now. Kate, my specific, they can stay, and most of them are here for that reason.